Klamath River is what brings us life.
We're at Ishipishi Falls, down here dip netting, traditional Kudup way of fishing, at our sacred ceremonial fishing spot. And very fortunate there's salmon here this year. This year, I'm actually living, where some years you don't feel like it so much when the fish ain't here and you're fish people.
Salmon signifies our ceremonies. It signifies what time of year it is. Kudu people believe that if the salmon are no longer in the river, humans are no longer on the land. And they put the dams in, it blocked off hundreds of miles of the pristine habitat that our salmon needed. To have these dams removed is going to restore the culture of our people.
Really, dam removal is just the first step to restoration. There's no point in doing restoration anywhere else if you don't get the dam out of the river.
The goal of the project is to remove four old hydroelectric dams and open up about 450 miles of fish habitat upstream of the lowermost dam. This is the largest river restoration dam removal project that's ever been undertaken.
We're looking at about 2,200 acres of restoration between the four reservoirs.
You can imagine the complexities that come along with an undertaking like this. With the Renewal Corporation and their dam removal contractor removing the dams, and then the company I work for, Res, following up with the restoration of the reservoir footprints and some key priority tributaries. There have been people that have devoted their lives to dam removal on the Klamath River, and I'm eternally grateful to them. And I want all those folks to know that this is real. This is happening, and it's being done by people that really, truly care.
Here, we're coming down to the J.C. Boyle powerhouse. Water runs from the dam down the power canal, comes about 2 miles downriver, runs through a tunnel in the mountain to the two generators that are down here at the powerhouse.
That same amount of water keeps moving. Coming down from there, Copco number one dam, Copco number two dam, and Iron Gate dam. What's feeding the upper basin and feeding the headwaters of the Klamath River is some of the most beautiful, pristine water. There are some pretty incredible, hopeful pockets of cold water and springs that are producing that water between J.C. Boyle Dam and Copco Lake. Right now, that very cold water heats up and you lose all the benefits of it. Algae blooms, dissolved oxygen goes down, and then it's killing fish. We've seen fish kills for the past 20 years. It's a bad time to be a fish in the Klamath River. We remove those thermal sinks, what we end up with is getting the cold water from the river flowing through the system. It's not getting stopped to get heated up.
Dam removal is just the first step to restoration. The dams come out, the rivers are flowing back in their main channel again. And before dam removal is even complete, we're already getting vegetation established on the reservoir sediments.
We are going to revegetate the area using native seeds that are collected. They're not commercially available. Started partnering with the Yurok tribe to do the seed collection.
The Yurok tribe, they've got a very large and robust fisheries construction division that's going to be a great resource when it's time to start building the physical restoration of the project. The Karuk tribe has an amazing fisheries department, and they're helping us identify opportunities for protection of fisheries resources during dam removal. The Klamath tribes in the upper basin have a world-class water quality laboratory, and we've entered into a partnership with them to monitor the evolution of poor water quality to improve water quality over the course of the project. We're working with tribal members who have a absolutely vested interest in putting the river back, getting the river healthy.
I'm personally really excited to see salmon and steelhead getting back into Spencer Creek, kind of the uppermost main fish-bearing tributary on the mainstem Klamath River, upstream of the J.C. Boyle Dam.
Once the dams come down, we expect that Spencer Creek is going to be one of the streams that we see salmon quickly reoccupy because the habitat is such a high quality already. So we're down here, we're sampling environmental DNA.
You hold this out and we'll run the tube off of it. You don't need to stick the rod in, but basically just kind of...
Environmental DNA is a really powerful tool that helps tell a more complete picture of not only individual species that are coming back to an area, but the full assemblage, the full group of fish that are using that area. So we can use this now to say what was here when the dams were in place, and then we'll continue to sample when the dams come out to show the reintroduction of these fish.
Primary objectives here are reshaping the channel, getting vegetation reestablished on the reservoir sediments that become exposed, immediately bringing back high quality habitat for the anadromous fish. We're gonna be able to come out here and see salmon in a place where they haven't been in over 100 years.
After the dams come out, we're gonna be left with about 2,200 acres of former reservoir footprint. So what we've got to do is revegetate those whole areas. If we were to do nothing, it would end up dry and barren and full of invasives. So we're trying to go out and treat those areas right now that have high densities of them in our project area so that we can foster native growth during the restoration period. Res came onto the project in 2019. In 2019, I also started partnering with the Yurok tribe to do the seed collection.
I'm with the seed crew for the Yurok tribe, and today we are gathering Persia tridentata. I feel like our seeds are part of a legacy that I can leave behind. Our grandchildren will be able to see what we've planted here and what we're picking.
I got it.
Lomatium?
Yes.
Which one is this?
This one's Nudicaulae.
Nudicaulae.
So what would be good is if you, I'm leaving a little seed, you know, off of each one, because I don't like stealing it all.
Mm-hmm.
So leave a little bit of seed, but take most, because that's a valuable plant for us. There's a major interaction between cultural knowledge of plants and the science of it. Having those two values really just makes it an important target for a restoration project. Native vegetation is the foundation of any good restoration project. So far, we've collected 98 different species.
And with that comes propagating over 11 billion seeds. Our goal is to get to 17 billion.
We're a native seed farming operation. We grow native grasses and wildflowers for restoration projects all around the entire West. We focus on getting materials that are actually going to fit the sites they come from, have the local adaptations in place so they can be returned to the environments they'll work in best. We're standing right here in a field of blue bunch wheatgrass. This is a ecotype for the Klamath River Renewal Project. And we're working with them to take a handful of seed and get it up to the hundreds or thousands of pounds they'll need so that they have the local genetics that are adapted to that area. There's many blue bunch wheatgrasses, but every one of them's different. So this is the adaptation for the Klamath Basin, and it's what they need for the restoration to be successful. We've done about 19 species here on their grow out and seed increase project, and so now, after the years that we've been working, we probably have several billion seeds.
The Creek Fisheries Program has been studying salmon in the mid-Klamath for, you know, over 20 years. So we're coming to Horse Creek today to look at some habitat projects that the Karuk tribe constructed over the last 10 years. Off-channel ponds and large wood structures. Part of the dam removal is drawing down reservoirs that have sediment trapped in the reservoirs, and that sediment's going to mobilize through the Klamath River. So as a precautionary measure, we're going to relocate some portion of that population into these off-channel ponds. We have a really strong monitoring component built into everything we do.
This pit tag project gives us real live data as fish are moving through the system, from its juvenile stage to its out-migrating stage to its return stage.
Within 2 or 3 years, we're seeing not a handful of coho, but hundreds of coho spawning in here.
With the restoration in the former dam footprints, we're going to be adding features like large wood into it to really bring up the habitat value quickly.
Adding structure, you know, not only provides immediate benefits and cover and spawning gravel for salmon, it also adds the building blocks for the riparian forest to come back. It's a good starting point in restoration.
We're here today to look at our restoration site with Resource Environmental Solutions Res so that we can have a conversation about the importance of restoration to us as tribal people. It's a good example of our capacity, and it also mirrors in a lot of ways the dam removal project itself. We can show the example of what it looks like, how we implement, how we talk, how we look at the world around us, and hopefully continue to build that relationship with Res.
We've been working with the Yurok tribe for 3 years. We get down here as often as we can to see what they're doing, see the work that's been going on.
Like, I tell youngsters all the time about what I do, and they're just like, they don't believe this job like exists. They're like, what? Like, you do that? And then I'll show them like pictures of like before and after pictures of like some of our projects, and they're just like blown away. It's the coolest job I've ever had.
When we showed up, this was a big old meadow. So our goal was to open this meadow back up, turn it back into fish habitat.
We believe that humans are part of this world, that we're part of this landscape, that we belong here. We're not just restoring this earth or this ground, we're restoring our people as well, our tribal members. We've been doing this since the beginning of time. It's what we were placed here to do. This is the conversation for this project. This is the conversation for dam removal.
Res is one of a very select few companies who are able to take on the level of ecological risk associated with a project like this. And then we guarantee its success. And in this case, we guarantee its success until criteria are met that have been developed in concert with the state and federal resource agencies and some of the local tribes.
We've always been fighting to restore the balance of this ecosystem. And the 50,000 foot view of what's happening here, this is a project that heals our entire ecosystem.
We're all working incredibly hard, everyone on this project. I've never been on a project that so many people have come forward to give so much to make sure it happens.
Collaboration is the key. Without collaboration, you're just by yourself.
It's very meaningful because of all of the partners on the project that I get to work with. The opportunity to help restore the landscape and the habitat for what once was the third largest salmon fishery on the West Coast.
When the dams come down, they're gonna let us live again. We're gonna be living again.